Good afternoon, people of God. Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. I hope and I pray that all is well with you. I would like to continue about a theme that I studied. I think I did like a couple of videos about it, the dangers of ancestor worship. And I'm adamant. I really believe that ancestor worship is bad. I grew up and I participated actively in ancestor worship until the Holy Spirit came in my life and he opened my eyes to his truth. And truth is a name. Truth comes from Christ, from Jesus, because he's the way, the truth, and the life. So I think it's been 20 some years, I would say 25, give and take, that I haven't talked to the dead ancestors and all that. I renounced it, I denounced it, I left that world, and it was not easy. It was not easy, I'm telling you, because I was seeing them, my dead ancestors, because I know them. I told you my father was king. I come from a royal lineage. We could go back. The last that I can, the names and all that, up to the 15th century, but before that, I need to go back to the village and ask. But what I'm saying is, I'm very serious about it. I am here to declare and to state that ancestor worship is bad. Ancestor worship is not good, and you cannot serve two masters and please both of them. I'm here to say that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and truth is exclusive. Truth is not inclusive. Either I'm lying or I'm telling the truth. We cannot have both. Either I'm producing a clean water or dirty water. We cannot have both from the same source. Having said that, 4 days ago, I was praying. It was around 2 a.m. I was sitting on the floor, because when I finish praying, I sit and I wait for the Holy Spirit, because prayer is a dialogue. When we talk, we keep quiet and we wait for him to talk. And he's a king, so he might come after 5 minutes or he might make you wait. Regardless, I was waiting for him. And he came and he told me, he said, look, I saw having a vision. I saw my father's house. It's a farm, a house in Lubumbashi, in Katanga, where I come from. I was born and raised in that house, so I know the house. Even with my eyes closed, I can turn on the light and things like that. I know the back of my hand. And I say hearing voices in the house that I could not explain. I didn't know who they were. I say following the sound. And we do have a basement, because in Katanga, the weather is really cold. I think it's similar to South Africa. Our winters are like in South Africa. But that one, I opened the door and I saw people living down there, and I was looking at them like, who are you? And they were very dirty. It reminded me of movies, the way we see homeless people with stains on the face, you know? People that are dirty, it was obvious that it's been a while that they haven't had a good shower. And I saw a mother sitting on the floor eating ugali, we call it in Swahili, or fufu, they call it in some place. And she was feeding the child. And I looked at her, I asked her in Swahili, I said, what are you doing here? And she said, we live here. And she meant what she said. She said, we live here. I said, no, you don't. She said, yes, we do. All of us. And that's when I looked. There were like 200 people. Like 200 of them, male, female, older people with gray hair and babies crawling. But they were all dirty. And I was like, why are you so dirty? And the smell was really not pleasant. And then she said, we are here, and them too, them who? I looked in the corners, I could see tall people. They were giants. I'm 5'4", but those people were really taller than my ceiling right now. And I was like, oh my God, what's going on? And the vision stopped, and the smell left me. Because when you are in that moment, smells are very vivid, and the people are, their energy. I know who, when I'm talking to a dead person, I know when I'm talking to a living person, and I know when I'm talking to a demon. They don't come the same way. They don't talk the same way. And most of all, the impact that they want to have on you, because they are all bullies, they don't project it the same way. The vision stopped, and I was like, Holy Spirit, I need your help. You said, I'm here. I said, who are those people? They live in my father's house. He said, yes. I was like, why they are not family? He said, partially, they are what you call familiar spirit. I knew what familiar spirit was. I've been learning about deliverance. I mean, it's been 17 years that the Holy Spirit has given me this ministry. So I read a lot, I know a lot, and I told you, I go in class, I have classes where he's teaching me things. And I said, yeah, I know what familiar spirit is. He said, okay. So everywhere that you have ancestor worship, what is ancestor worship? We believe, we in Africa, they have it on every continent. They demonstrate it in different ways. So I'm just going to focus on Africa because my calling is to children of African descent, wherever they are in the world. And the way we do it in Africa, we believe that when the ancestors die, they go in a village where they are, they dwell. And from there, they can hear us, they can dialogue with us, they can give us messages, and we can go back and forth. And that's why we need a medium to be a go-between, a medium. And you could call that person a shaman, a witch doctor, a sangoma, a nganga. According to the place where you are, we have different names and different terms that we use for those people who are clairvoyant. They can go into different realms and come back with an answer. And so the Holy Spirit continues. He said, so when you Africans, in every family, you have, as we are right now, because the advantage that I have is that I know how life is in the village. I'm talking about the deep village, really. And then I know how life is in the city, and I know how life is here in the West. So I can, you know, I can see. But the thing is, if you go in any city in Africa, let's say Lubumbashi, my hometown, you have a population that know about ancestor worship. They do it, they practice it, and they're not ashamed of it. We have another population that will say, what is that? They don't know. They're clueless because they didn't. They were not taught about that thing. And then you have others that will say, oh no, I'm a believer outside. But when they close the doors, they do it inside. So I know people, you can go in their house, they will have a small table or a regular table with a plate and food, the same food that you eat and a bottle of beer or wine or whatever it is that you are having that day, set aside for the dead ancestors also. So when you feed the dead, when you are dead in Christ, Christ will take you with him and you are gone. And you don't talk to the dead, to the living, because you are gone. But when you are not in Christ, you are still in the cemetery, and there they have to fend for themselves. They need food. Some of them will need sex. Some of them will need money and all that. I've heard people saying, I went to the witch doctor and my grandfather is asking a perfume by Christian Dior, or my grandma is saying that she wants Chanel 5. And those are people who love the good life, because once upon a time, they were princes of God. They were accustomed to that good life. And we humans, while we are still here in the land of the living, we have access to so many good things that they don't have down there. So when you start feeding the dead, those dead will come and eat with you. So you create a tunnel, a line of communication between the living and the dead, and they can come and take. So when you give them food, you give them, let's say, whatever it is that you eat, you give them, they down there will divide it with the spirit. Those spirits are the people that I saw in the corner. They were really in the dark. I didn't see them well, like I can describe the features. Let me pause here. When we talk about, I hope, I don't know if you saw the movie Us with Lupita Nyong'o. The movie was written and directed by Jordan Peele. It's about a story of people living on top. The story is set in Los Angeles, I believe, and you have the same people down there. That's exactly that. That Jordan Peele guy knows so many things. I would like to talk to him. I would like to pick his brain, but I wonder. I don't think that he has the same source than me. But anyway, we, every family, every household have those people living beneath you beneath your house, underneath there, they live there. And why? You can say, no, we don't do ancestor worship right now, but this generation might, maybe you didn't, but the one above you, the one above, because we see blessings that are coming generation to from generation, and then we see curses, and then we see generational diseases to the point that people say, oh, diabetes is in our family, that's our disease. You are claiming it as if it was something really nice to brag about. Oh, we have dental issues, or we have heart conditions. Those are not good things because they keep coming back generation after generations. And those are things that we need to tackle and uproot. But in order to do that, you need to come with the power of the Holy Spirit, because it's a power that is contrary to that power. And what is that power? So the Holy Spirit told me, he said, I need to take you back to the beginning of the beginnings. And I'm going to the book of the beginnings. We are talking about the book of Genesis. People of God, this is not a joke. The Bible is real. God is real. His structure and everything that he represents is real. And we have an enemy who has a side also. I'm not scared of them anymore. Thank God I've been set free. And that's freedom came through Jesus. That salvation came by the person of Jesus, Yeshua Mashiach, the Son of God, the one who died on the cross. That's the one I'm talking about. Because there are so many gods out there, but I have only one God. He's the creator of heaven and earth, and he's my redeemer. So I'm confessing him, because if I'm still alive, it's because of him. If I'm still sane with everything that he's showing me, because my ministry is really ugly, things that he's showing me are really... You know, yesterday, I thought that I was going to die. I was so bad. After that assault, they came to attack me in a way that I've never seen before. And all I kept hearing is, yeah, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. I had to go through it, and I did, and I came out, and I'm fine. I'm fine. And yesterday at this time, I was so bad. I'm really hurting. I feel like I tackled, you know, like a mini giant, like a sumo squeezed me or something. But that's the reality of spiritual warfare. And they lost. I'm still here. I'm still alive, and I give him the glory. But I'm testifying with you because it's been 3 days that he explained this to me, and I was not feeling well. I was really overwhelmed by this revelation. It might look easy to you, but when I received it, it really shook me to the core, because I understand so many things, the rejection from my family. People don't want to talk to me. I have people who really cut me off. They are playing psychology, you know, like they don't invite you to parties. They don't tell you when there is a wedding. They don't tell you when there is a dowry. All that means so much to us in our culture. But I'm glad that the Holy Spirit really centered me. I really am firmly standing on the rock of my salvation. So that's what matters the most, to have him with me, because he takes care of my finances and everything else. So come and go, I don't care. I just care about having the Holy Spirit. So let's go back to my story. So we got there, and the Holy Spirit told me, he said, I need to take you back to the book of Genesis. And I could see the year 2020. It was really weird, like special effects in Hollywood. And then we got to biblical times. It was in English. He was talking to me in English, not in French. And I saw Genesis 6. I was like, okay, the sons of God who went into the daughters of men and they produced men of renown, the giants, the heroes. And he told me, say, who are the men of renown today? Being from California, I was living in the city of Hollywood. I told him those celebrities, you know, he said exactly. So they are housing those old ones, the spirit of the past. And so those spirits, while they were alive, they were an abomination to God because they were not supposed to be here. And they were angelic by their father and human by their mother. So they were hybrid creatures. And those people, because they were male and female, they came, yes, we have feminine angels. I think it's in the book, Ido of Zechariah, where they talk about two women with wings carrying a basket iniquities in the basket and they go throw iniquity in the river. Oh, I forgot that verse. It's in the Old Testament. Just Google two women carrying a basket with iniquity, two women with wings. So if they have wings and they are female, so that means they're angelic because I'm a female but I don't have wings. Anyway, so those giants, those Nephilim, produced offsprings, and those offsprings died because it didn't happen just one generation. We had many generations. I will send you back to the book of Enoch and the book of Jubilees, the book of we have many books in the Apocrypha that mention, and they are really, they give so many details. And so they had children, and those children were mixed hybrid. And when the flood came, because the flood is a reality, Noah was real with his family, with the ark, and we know the story. I hope you know the story. They died. They died in the water, except those that was water spirit. I will talk about them some other time. But those that were, that died, the spirit were roaming. They didn't have a place to go. And they became the demons. And those demons, or evil spirit, that are tormenting spirit, they still need food, they still need sex, they still need a nice perfume and nice things. And the best way to do that, because the goal was to steal the glory from God while they were alive. And even dead, they are pursuing the same agenda. They want to steal the glory from God. So, and they need food, they want to be worshipped. They have that insatiable need to be praised and worshipped. Exactly like we see the star in Hollywood, they want people to clap for them. They have a deficit of self-love, self-everything. And so they started talking to people through in their dreams and telling them, I'm your father, Louis, I passed away, you know, I'm dead, but I'm hungry, I need food. And Louis will say, the father, the spirit will say, I'm your dad, go under that tree, can you put me rice, a chicken leg, and a glass of wine? And Louis will wake up and say, oh, my father passed away, and my father talked to me, and he needs food. And they will go put the food there. And that's how ancestor worship started, the need of venerating, because it became such an obsession that I know families that do it every month. They do it every month, a goat, a cow, a chicken, and they will do that for the dead ancestors. So that need to be praised continues today, that needs to be acknowledged continues today, that needs to be fed because they need food continues to this day. That's what we call ancestor worship. So if I go back to my family, we are feeding them, let's say once a month, we kill a lamb or a goat for them. We are here above, and they believe they receive that. And they eat, they can eat, they can receive the life, because the life is in the blood, from that, the, that goat's blood gives them life. Anything goes in that realm, because they are so deprived. Remember the story with Jesus when he saw that lunatic, and he told me, who are you? He said, we are legion. My name is legion, for we are many. And then he asked him, he said, can we go in the pigs? So even a pig is better than go back where they are, because it's terrible. They need life. They suck the life out of this realm of ours. So if we feed them blood, they will eat. And when they eat, we merge. It's like a consolidation. We become so close and so tight that after a while, I don't need to give them food. They will just come and take food for me. It's like a marriage, like an agreement, like a partnership. And the problem with that is, I might be here in Los Angeles, but somewhere in my village, the one who is the priest of the family will say, we are going to kill a goat today for the dead ancestors. And we start naming children. And we tell the dead, we say, can you follow our children in America, follow our children in Europe? And they will come and visit you. I'm not joking, I used to dream about them, my dead ancestors, and they will come and visit me. And I will wake up and say, I dreamed about my grandma, I dreamed about my grandpa. I didn't connect that with the familiar spirit, and I was not a believer at that time. I was a Christian, a Catholic, that's what I was. And sadly, I didn't even know how to pray. So the Holy Spirit says, that's what they do. And when they start coming, taking food, they will take 50% of your revenues and divide it 50% with the dead that were members of the family, and 50% the giant, the man of renown, will take. And that's how they eat. And that's, we see that in every family that ancestor worship has been done even once. Once only is enough to open a doorway. It's like an elevator going up and down, and that's what they do. So that's what I received from the Holy Spirit. It was so disturbing because I had to pray, I had to sever ties, I had to break those elevators, because that's what they are, they're elevators. It was not an easy assignment, I'm telling you. And I'm telling you this so that you have the information, so that you know how to pray and what to pray about. Because you can be here in America very far, but your soul is still there with those people because you are one of them. So you need a new, to be, the only way to get out is to be a new creature in Christ. The only way to change that is through Christ. The only way to beat and vanquish that system is with Christ. The only way is to know that you know that you know that Christ is with you, because then everything that Christ has will be positioned in a way. I saw angels. I've never talked to you about angels. I saw beings that I've never seen before. I've never seen before, and I'm amazed. I'm amazed, and that's where we are. We are in the last and perilous times. Things are very, nothing is certain anymore. And we need to pray, we need to seek deliverance. And this is not the kind of thing that you can come out with, or come out from, by just saying, oh, I don't do ancestor worship. You need a little bit more than that. You need a good dose of repentance, humility, and really repent and give yourself to Christ the right way. That's how you are going to come out from this thing, because it's real, people of God. They will come and eat with you and take from your resources. They will deprive you. And then if you don't, you persevere, you don't want to give in to the prompting, they will come, they will be very aggressive. I've heard about people being raped by those spirits because they don't want to let you go. They need your power, they need your energy, like a battery. And then they will start negotiating, like, okay, I cannot tell you how many times I saw people telling me, okay, we'll give you 60 and we keep 40. And I'm like, what are we negotiating here? I refuse. I've seen people with a checkbook telling me, ready, with not a roll, a pen, but with a fountain pen. I write only with fountain pen. That's what really caught my attention, a gold fountain pen. And they were telling me, state your amount, how much you want, we are going to give it to you, but stop what you're doing, you need to stop praying. So they are going to come and try to coerce you, try to buy you, and if you don't, then they are going to attack you, buy you, your car will die, your microwave will just die on you, your TV will die on you. And it's only with the protection of Jesus Christ that you can, is going to protect you from those kind of assaults, because I've been there, done that. I'm telling you, it's not a joke. It's not a joke. And it's real. Ancestor worship is bad. And this is the origin of ancestor worship. I've been asking, praying, pondering about it, and now I have the answer. Now I understand that even after all, the Garden of Eden is on the continent of Africa, in East Africa. So we were, because of that lie that the Bible is about Caucasian people, but pink people. On one hand, every picture represents pink people with blue eyes, blonde hair, but living in the Middle East, at that time, everybody else, I mean, everyone else around them, they were melanized people. So that created like a discrepancy in our mind. We believe it and we don't. We see the Bible like a joke, because we still have those pictures in our head. When I watch a movie and Adam and Eve, they are blonde with blue eyes. I'm like, what kind of dirt produced pink skin? Please, somebody show me. But that's where we are. That's what I wanted to share with you. The Bible is real. God is real. Satan is real. He is not to be feared, because once in Christ, then we have the Son of God will take care of us, and he's going to protect us. He's alive. I see what he does for me. I see the way he takes care of me. I might be, you know, like what I told you earlier, I vomited a lot. I had a severe case of diarrhea, but I'm fine today. I'm fine, and the strength that I gained is just out of this world. So each time that there is a victory, the Holy Spirit is there, and he's the one giving me the victory, and it's because of him that I'm still here, and I give him all the glory. That's what I wanted to share with you. Ancestor worship is real, and it's bad. I renounced it 25 years ago. I denounced it. It's bad, and it saddens me to see African Americans go back to it. They are searching, they are looking, sometimes the wrong way. I see them on Instagram. How many times did I argue with people? They call me names, like I'm a traitor, I'm a sellout, I need to take my medicine, I'm scared to worship my ancestors. I'd rather go talk to the Creator instead of talking to a creature. I'd rather go straight to the source, to the one who created me. You know, it's like I take my phone to Apple. Apple is going to fix it. Why go pay someone else to fix what Apple can do? God created me, so I go straight to him. When I'm sick, I go to him. When I'm scared, I go to him. When I need money, I go to him. When I'm healed, I'm sick in my body, he's going to take care of me. He's more than able. He has shown me so many things. He's faithful. He's true, he's alive, and he's powerful. Just as powerful today as he has ever been, he's God. He's God. He doesn't need me to be God. He was God before me, he's going to be God after me. And he's real. So we need to change. We need to think and analyze. We need to choose wisely, because to every choice there is a consequence. To every action there is a reaction. So when you talk to the dead ancestors, who are you talking to, and what kind of line of communication are you establishing, are you building? And they are going to come. To come not only to you, but to your children. Because they can be very vindicative. Those spirit of reclamation, they like to come and claim generations after generations. And they come with their thrones, they sit, they rule like kings. They come with their poison, they make you sick. In the book of Samuel, we see that, I think it's 1 Samuel 8:13, where the children of God ask Samuel, they say, we want to be like every other people around us. We need a king, we need a king. And God answers them and says, look what that king is going to do to you. That's what ancestor worship does to people. It does. There is nothing good about ancestor worship. And in conclusion, I didn't say that in my French video, but if the dead ancestors were so powerful, how come they didn't vanquish the white people? How come they didn't vanquish the colonizer? What, those people who are in Ifa, I defy you, Yoruba, the Orisha, Bakishi, whatever the name you choose, they have many names, they have many systems. It's very elaborate. There is a pantheon of God, of spirit. It's well established. How come they didn't help when the white men came? Where were they? They are dead. They don't have power. They are dead. And I rather put my trust in a living God, because I'm receiving life from him. That's what I wanted to share with you. I will do more videos tomorrow as my strength comes back. And God bless you. And I pray that you are going to have the wisdom to choose wisely and not go have a reading, a psychic reading, Cori, you know, the shell reading, and say, this is what we used to do in Africa. I understand the need to reconnect with your origins, but you need to pick good from evil. You have good things in Africa and you have bad things in Africa. You have the Spirit of God that is touching people of African descent in a way that is very rare here in the West. That trust, that communication, the trust that he wants from people, it's very strong on the African continent. People, when they understand, like someone like me, I understand who God is, and now I know who the dead ancestors are, I've made up my mind. And he's my friend, I'm a tool in his hand, I'm a hammer in his hand, I'm destroying evil everywhere that I will be able to talk. I will talk and I will explain and expose ancestor worship. Ancestor worship is bad. I renounce it. I denounce it. There is nothing good in it. If you want to know about your history, start interviewing old people and write your tree. I know mine. I can go back to the 15th century. So I don't need to talk to the dead anymore. I don't need to give them a cow. I don't need to give them a nice perfume by Acqua di Parma or what have you. So that's what I wanted to share with you. Ancestor worship is very bad. And this is the beginning of ancestor worship. We need to go back to Genesis 6. That's where it started. So for those of you who are Africans, where they told you that the Bible is not for us, they lied to you, or the person didn't have the right information. Our beginnings start in the book of Genesis. We, people of African descent, we melanized people, that we need to go back to the book. We need to go back to our creator. We need to go back to our origins. And that's what I wanted to share with you. May the peace of God be with you. We are in very dangerous times. I pray that you are protected from the corona. I pray for President Trump and the First Lady, Melania. I pray for them. And we need to pray for peace. We need to pray against the spirit of civil war in this nation. We need to pray against civil unrest and attacks from one ethnicity to another. We need to pray against that, because you have people that are really, 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 they need to offer blood. And it's the end of the year. October is here. Halloween is coming soon. They want to create chaos, and so that they can come with the new order. But there is a God. And if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, I am one of them. I'm standing in the gap. I'm praying. Did you know that there is a government of Christ in America and one in Africa? And I have the privilege to be in both. It's really weird and eerie to be consulted and to be informed of dangers, of evil things that are coming. But God, that He still does that. Call unto me and I will answer. I will show you great and mighty things that you do not know. He didn't joke when He said that. He does. He will reveal to you things. And the more you go, the more, when you enlarge your shoulders and enlarge your scope of influence, then you become a tool and you are destroying with peace and serenity. It's wonderful. I love it. I love to put orders. I love to put back things in the right order. Okay, I don't want to keep you too long. God bless you, and I'll talk to you tomorrow.